So the next speaker. I promised you that we were moving on from professors to practitioners, and I sort of fudged, because the person that we have next is both a very prominent academic and a very prominent practitioner. And I wanted to read you the bio paragraph that she sent, simply because I can't capture what a rich and diverse career that Dr. Segenet Kelemu has had without actually reading this. I can't commit all of this to memory. So here we go. She's a molecular plant pathologist with a PhD in molecular plant pathology at Kansas State University. She's also director of the Biosciences Eastern and Central African Hub. A native of Ethiopia, she's experienced, and now I'm reading, the challenges and successes associated with African agriculture firsthand, from field to high-tech laboratory. Under her leadership since 2007, BecA Hub research capacities, staff, facilities, fundings, partners, and training programs have been expanded at an ever-accelerating pace. Her drive for success and achievement was ingrained early on. She was the only woman in Ethiopia to graduate with the Haile Selassie I Honors List Award in 1974, was at the top of her class. She joined the International Center for Tropical Agriculture as a senior scientist. Later was the leader there of the Crop and Agro-System Health Management, and was awarded or recognized with an outstanding senior scientist award. I could go on for about two more paragraphs, but I think probably the easiest thing to do would be to turn the microphone over to her and have her share more with you about her very long and interesting work.
Thank you. I would like to thank the organizers, particularly Danny and my friend Debbie, for this opportunity. This is my first time to Israel, but I grew up in a village remote corner of Ethiopia, and I grew up also listening to my father praying quietly every morning to the God of Israel. And he prayed actually for all of you to protect the children of Israel, the Holy Land, and so on. So as a child, actually, I thought there is a separate, special God for Israel. Although I did not know Israel was a country at the time, as when I was a kid. And my mother took me to the Orthodox Ethiopian Coptic Church every Sunday almost, and she would tell me to pray. But I didn't pray. I was contemplating the whole time, which God? Should I go pray to the God of Israel, my father's God, or to my mother's God? And I really grew up confused. But I'm really glad to be in Israel. I think if had my father been alive, he would have been very, very proud. And so thank you. So I like this term, food security practitioner. I really like it, but I also grew up really facing food insecurity. So I'm now happy to be a practitioner. So I think I don't want to go into what food security is. The whole morning people talked about it, but I just want to emphasize that it's not just production. It is a necessary, agricultural production is necessary, but it's not sufficient. So you need quantity, you need quality, and you need also a nutritious food continuously accessible to the household in terms of meeting that food security. I think food security is also a basis for really a nation's stability. It's a basis for peace and really for people to lead a productive life. So I can't emphasize the importance of that. So the drivers for a food production challenge, as all of you know, is population growth, economic development, diet change, and food waste, and so on. And now I think biofuels and climate change also play a role in driving food production challenge. So in general, I think as all of we know, there is no really silver bullet for food security. It's a very complex issue. and several actions are needed. And some of them, pathways, one is reducing demand, and so reduction of waste and overconsumption, I think. The latest figure I've seen in overconsumption and obesity in U.S., and they, for example, also the weight loss program in U.S. is at $60 billion at the moment. So I think that is really a major issue. I used to tell an American colleague of mine, a staff member, that I think U.S. worries a lot about Al-Qaeda, but I think they should worry more about the obesity problem. I think developing a smart biofuel, also policy and technology, really would contribute to reducing demand. Filling the production gap, I think there are various ways, including expansion of land and irrigation and so on, but these are, as you know, also the resources are also limited. We don't have unlimited water or unlimited land. And yield, increasing yields through technologies, I'll talk more about that. I think some of these technologies are also useful in reducing or filling the production gap. Losses, avoiding loss, as some people in earlier in the morning have talked about, disease and pest. I think Debbie has talked a lot about soil and degradation problem, particularly in Africa, and climate change mitigation and adaptation to climate change also would avoid the loss. By 2050, it's expected, estimated 1 billion extra tons of cereal grains are needed for the growing population, and some of these are divided into livestock feed, biofuels, and human consumption. So that's quite a bit of grain needed. And I think the issue of biofuel is real. One figure I have seen is about 240 kilograms of grain is needed to produce 100 liters of fuel. And that 240 grams of grain is enough to feed 1% a year. So this is real, not only in terms of grain, but also a competition for land and water to grow those biofuel crops, even if it's not a grain-based biofuel. Food security, and I think you can't talk about food security or insecurity without talking about Africa. So production, slightly increasing, but still it doesn't meet the growth, the population growth. And Africa also relies heavily on imports, and I think the investment in agriculture usually is also neglected. And just to show you some figure, these are the kind of animal product imports for 2007 in Africa. So the region had an estimated total import of US $44 billion worth of agriculture products. So this is really not sustainable. And the cereal yields are also increasing elsewhere except in sub-Saharan Africa. So this, even increasing that yield to a level achieved elsewhere, would really go a long way in Africa. So business as usual, doing the same thing over and over expecting different results, doesn't work. It's borderline stupid, actually. So we have to do things differently. So in 2002-2003, the African Union and NEPAD and some institutions and governments got together to build some centers of excellence across Africa to do some of the intractable problems in agriculture production and agriculture through modern biosciences. So four centers of excellence were built with a a grant from the government of Canada. So the first one is what the Biosciences System in Central Africa have, based in Nairobi at the International Livestock Research Institute, which I'm leading. So the majority, large proportion of the fund, which is about $30 million, was invested to build infrastructure and build capacity in biotechnology in Kenya. So these are the blue-colored countries are the countries that we are responsible for. 18 Eastern and Central African countries, it was 17, but with the birth of South Sudan, it's 18. So from 2007 until 2009, we built the infrastructure. Seven laboratories, ultra-modern laboratories, ranging from biosafety level 1 to 3, on crops, livestock, and microbial biosciences. So we were also at the same time building capacity, critical mass of scientists. So we have at the moment 36 core scientists and technical staff. We have 12 positions to fill this year, so I see quite a few young people here. So there's a lot of job opportunities there. Come and join us. You too, okay. For you, we have other. And we brought in also partners, many partners. We have 45 in animal health and 18 from different CG centers that are based there with us. And we have a number of also affiliated scientists from Australia, US, and elsewhere also who work with us as partners. So these are some of the partnership we have built over the year. So I would like to add institutions like yours, Danny, so that's the plan I have for you to join us also for this year. This will be, I hope, an entry point for Israel to join us in this journey to combat some of the food security problem in Africa. So we have managed to build a large a number of partners as well as donors supporting our programs. So what are the core activities? We do research, of course, and capacity building and training is a strong component that supplements the research. We also do research services and DNA sequencing and genotyping and oligosynthesis and other areas. And recently we added also a product incubation development also program also within our activities. We have various core competencies in genomics, bioinformatics, genetic engineering, both animals and crops, molecular diagnostics, molecular breeding, marker-assisted selection development, vaccine and mycotoxin research and diagnostics. Just to show you some of the partnership we have a very strong partnership with CSIRO in Australia and supported with a $14 million grant from the government of Australia. And it has supported seven projects in animal health, African swine fever, PPR and CPVP, and development of vaccine and diagnostics methods for small ruminants and the pigs. We have also a strong capacity building also along with it. And also a portion of it also goes to access also skills from Australia. We have last year also set up a similar partnership with Sweden and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs put $12 million into this. And it has three major projects that will contribute to food and nutritional security in Africa. It has also capacity building, a strong capacity building component into this, and some infrastructure upgrade for bioinformatics. So we have other partnerships set in this form, funded by the Gates Foundation and other donors as well. So we access basically this type of partnerships also allow us to access skills globally and particularly in these specific countries and in multiple institutions. With institutions, crop centers that are hosted with us at BecA. We have four centers and major projects, basically to develop crops resistant to drought. Major projects, about eight major projects funded by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. We have two projects on to develop drought-tolerant maize for Africa and water-efficient maize for Africa, and transgenic bananas also that are out in the field to combat bacterial wilt disease in Uganda. We have also two major transgenic crops in work in to combat late blight in potato and sweet potato, and many others. And the laboratory of Willy has contributed also technology. We have now a cassava transformation capacity as well at BecA. So there is money. All these projects, major projects, used to be done in Latin America, in Europe, in U.S. because of lack of facilities. They are all now in Africa, being conducted for Africa. And all of this also have a strong capacity building component into this. So as I have indicated, capacity building is a very strong activity that we have. And our objective is to really strengthen capacity within Africa in bioscience area and to support African scientists to do cutting-edge science. And also we promote also to provide access to a cutting-edge facility, which many African institutions don't have. So the various activities, we have graduate students placements, we have African visit and non-African visiting scientists program. We do institutional capacity building, and we do also training in various different areas. For example, last year we ran 11 hands-on practical training courses in various areas of biotechnology, and 61 experts from around the world participated, donated their time to give training to our African partners. So this is also one area that Tel Aviv University can participate, I think, and can support us in this. We have about 58 graduate students at the moment registered anywhere in the world, but they do their research on African agricultural constraints in BecA. So a new, very innovative capacity building program that we started is what we call through African Bioscience Challenge Fund, where African scientists bring their own priority research area that is of priority to food or nutritional security in their countries. They bring it to BecA. They acquire new techniques, and they do the research there for up to 6 months. And this is really generating very new, innovative results in this area. For example, a scientist from Makerere, for the first time, made a cross between effectively between maize and sorghum. I think he is the first in the world to do that. So there are a lot of innovative things coming through this program. And I think this is something different, which we think is going to make a big difference. So for this year, we'll be receiving about 50 African scientists through this program. Last year, we supported 17 scientists through this. And so there are a number of donors that are contributing, and that is also expanding. So there is no problem of funding, as even somebody was saying about donors. So we also provide research-related services. We have two core units that do DNA sequencing and genotyping, both capillary sequencing and next generation 454. And this is complemented with a strong bioinformatics platform. And this year we are adding a nutritional analysis platform for food safety and nutrition. So these are some of the services that we are providing. And last year we provided services for 25 countries and 11 international organizations. including countries outside of Africa, US, UK, Asia, and Latin America. So this is also a first trend. No one in the past would ever send samples for DNA sequencing in Africa. But this is any trend is coming. So this is a very successful. This service, we run it as a commercial. So for the first time now, it is actually generating profit, which goes back into the research. So this is just some of the machines that we have. As I indicated, our bioinformatics is very strong, and we have capacity, parallel capacity, genome assembly, annotation, analysis, and so on. So we have various projects, including large genome sequencing. Part of the cassava genome is being resequenced here. And last year, we completed about 60 viral genome sequencing, and 14 of them are submitted to the gene bank. So we are contributing to the global knowledge base as well. So we have added new platforms. We are adding now a diagnostics platform together for both crop and animal diseases. And we have assembled also a great deal of partnership, including USAID, USDA, Plum Island in New York. And the mycotoxin detection platform is going to be the only platform in sub-Saharan Africa. So we are assembling at the moment. So things are happening. So there are a lot of opportunities. Thank you. We have plenty. I'm almost done. The opportunities, I think the facilities to conduct modern biosciences is brought to Africa through the BecA Hub at a scale that we think would have an impact. The capacity also we are doing, building in among African scientists is also, we feel and we believe we can do that in sufficient numbers in Africa to make a difference. We are also leveraging the expertise and agenda of other CGIAR centers and global partners, including Australia, Cornell, Swedish universities, and so on. And I mean it. I hope that we add Israel to this, because I think, as Debbie has mentioned, there are a lot that Israel can contribute, technologies that are applicable to and relevant to Africa. So we facilitate and add value also. And BecA is considered as a success story that it is currently being duplicated for Latin America, funded by the Development American Bank. Nigeria, together with UNESCO, is also duplicating it. And recently, I saw a report of a strong recommendation that BecA to be duplicated for the health center also. So for the health sector somewhere in Africa or Asia. So this is, I think, one positive story that's happening in Africa. So as a whole also, I believe, and I think we believe that the future is really bright for Africa. I think positive things are happening. The economy of a number of countries is really growing at a healthy rate, better than Europe in many areas. Conflict, you know, Africa used to be a very conflicted place. Those are, I think, changing also. Democracies are coming. Infrastructure is really also improving. China is completely transforming Africa in terms of roads, bridges, and so on. Ethiopia is, for me, beyond recognition at the moment. China is transforming it. Internet access use is also increasing. Investment is also increasing. China is investing. Australia has shifted its emphasis from Asia to Africa, that in the next few years they plan to invest about $1 billion a year in Africa, in agriculture and in mining and so on. There are links also being formed by with support of like foundations like Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation with Brazil, so and many things are happening, and I hope also links with Israel and Africa would be also formed there. And I think, as someone mentioned also, policies, federal policies are important, agricultural policies. I think we are in that also, moving in the right direction also. And investment in education is also is coming. So I think there are a lot of bright things that are happening in Africa. It's just they are not happening fast enough, plenty enough to make fast change. But I think the continent is moving in the right direction, and the time is really ripe for science and technology also to further contribute to that move. BecA, as I said, because this is unique, this is something positive, so we receive more than 1,500 visitors a year, including Bill Gates was there, the Kenyan president, and last year the German chancellor was also there. And often these visits are also positive. They come, they are followed with funding also possibilities. So this is good. Thank you. And this is currently the BecA team. We are 36 from 8 countries, but this is a core team. We are adding 12 people this year, 12 positions, and until 2015, we want to increase that base at least by 10, 12 people every year. So we are expanding. But as I said, this is a small team for a large 18 countries, but a lot of the work we do with partners globally, and those partners also that are based there with us. So I just want to acknowledge also our donors, the Canadian government. There was an initial $30 million infrastructure investment. Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Agriculture provides core funding of $1 million a year. OSAID and CSRO that provides also a large funding, about $2 million, $3 million a year. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and so on. And many others that I can put in there. So funding is not a problem, but the critical problem we are facing is attracting actually staff. Recruitment is a problem. Although that we provide a very competitive international package, still attracting, I think, the top is very, very difficult. So I hope that we get a few people who would be interested to work with us. Thank you. Next.
We have time for one or two questions, if there are.
That's an excellent question. I think at the end, unless this is taken from the lab to reach that, all this is in vain. It will not be useful. So we have various mechanisms. We have development partners. We have also farmers association groups, leaders usually who also partner. There are also small private sectors that are really sprouting all across Africa. Those are also partnering. For example, we have a new project on tissue culture to rejuvenate or develop tissue culture protocols for endangered African plants that are on the verge of extinction, that are identified by each country as something. So we develop those, and the private sector links up with us. So there are a number of tissue culture private sector that are partners in that project with us. So we have also national programs also that usually are the authorized bodies that release varieties, if there are improved varieties, for example. Those are also, they work with us also. But I think one of the problems in across Africa is that the extension system really has completely weakened over the past several years. So that is also an area that needs to be strengthened for us for our output to really make a difference. But that is a critical area which is still, we are still finding our way to fill that gap. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah.